several named lectures, and the Turing Lecture series is among them. And this lecture and also the workshop that's surrounding it is focused on looking at theoretical aspects of biology. And you know, one of the main points of having a workshop like this is, you know, apart from understanding the research that's being done, it's also just to get a flavor of the kind of work that the kind of ways that theorists can contribute to understanding biology. And this is the reason why Bill is a perfect speaker to anchor this lecture series. And just like Vijay mentioned yesterday, Bill is first and foremost, so not only is he a pioneer in this field, but he's also an excellent teacher. And so good, in fact, that he's going to give this entire lecture on the blackboard, which is what he prefers to do. So you're going to have to look from all the way where that white line is to all the way where this orange line is. And I guess he's going to start on this side and work his way this way. Okay.
Again, it's a great pleasure to be here, and I've been enjoying this enormously. I've learned quite a lot already, and I want to talk today about biological networks, which have already made several appearances, and to fix our ideas, let's imagine making some description of a network, which to avoid using up too much of the board, won't be too large. And you know, you've all seen pictures like this. Occasionally there are problems with getting things onto the plane, so you have to do things like that. In these pictures, what one is meant to think is that in every one of the circles, there lives a variable, I don't know, we can call it xi. And then the arrows, which by convention have slightly different shapes in different cases, are meant to describe the interactions. Now, we can do this in many ways. So we might be thinking about a genetic network. In which case, what I mean by xi is the expression level of gene I. So it's essentially the concentration of the protein that eventually gets synthesized. Or you might count the messenger RNA molecules. But you know, one draws the same kinds of pictures when you're thinking not about networks of interacting genes, but also networks of interacting neurons. And in that case, you have a little, exactly what you mean by xi depends a bit on your formulation. If you were studying the neural network of C. elegans, the organism that has appeared several times already in this workshop, C. elegans neurons don't actually generate action potentials. And so the xi would be some continuous variable, like the voltage across the membrane, or the concentration of calcium in the cell, which would be a corollary of the voltage, but more experimentally accessible. For most neurons, however, they do generate action potentials. And if you really want to describe the state of the system on very short timescales, then if you slice time into very small bins, say 10 or even 20 milliseconds or smaller, then what you'll find is that in one of those time bins, either the neuron generates an action potential or it doesn't. So probably you're going to give a description of xi, which is intrinsically binary, which basically says that the neuron generated a spike or remain silent. In the case of a genetic network, these arrows represent the fact that the proteins which are being encoded by gene I are transcription factors, for example, which then regulate the expression of other genes. And so these arrows ultimately relate to the fact that the protein molecules X, the protein molecules whose concentration is being measured by XI, have to bind to particular sites along the DNA near the gene that codes for the protein J. In the case of a neural network, these interactions are supposed to represent actual synaptic connections. Let me remind you that if you don't observe all the variables in a system, there can be apparent interactions that don't actually correspond to direct connections in the usual sense, okay? And actually, I would caution you that in almost every case that we think about, we're not really observing all the variables. And so almost all the interactions are effective interactions anyway, no matter how hard we try to connect them to the underlying structural substrate. So in physics, we're very used to the idea of effective interactions. It doesn't bother us. In biology, it's a little more problematic. People have a tendency to want to identify the interactions that you write down with in a very direct structural way, and it's not always obvious that that's correct. I want to encourage you to think about a broader class of networks than these. Obviously, there are other examples already at the cellular level. You can think about networks in metabolism or other aspects of biochemical control. You can think about signaling networks and so on. But I also want you to think about things on very different scales. So for example, if you think about a single protein molecule, you know that that molecule often belongs to a family of proteins. And that family of proteins may exist within a single organism. So most obviously, we have a very large number of different antibody molecules in our immune system. But it may also exist as a family that you can find by looking across the evolutionary tree. So we all have serine protease. We have proteases that help us digest our food. And each of us, each organism, has several different kinds of proteases for carrying out different parts of the task of cutting up proteins. And then if you look across the tree of life, you can find analogs of these proteins, which are carrying out very similar functions and have essentially identical structures, but with different amino acid sequences. And so you can think about grouping all of these things into families. Some of them by now have been cataloged. The catalog of proteins that belong to a particular family can be measured in the many thousands. And if you look across that family, what you see is that certain aspects of the sequence are very strongly conserved, and other aspects are quite variable. Now, the structure of a protein emerges from the interactions among many of, essentially all of its amino acids. So you can think that just as the functional behavior of a network of neurons or a network of genes emerges from the interactions of these individual elements, so too the structure and function of a protein emerges from interactions among many amino acids. And across evolutionary time, the identity of those amino acids has been changed. And so there is a kind of dynamics wandering through the space of possible amino acid sequences. And so if I think about the evolution of protein families, I might also want to think about the network of amino acids that supports the structure needed to belong to this particular family. What is it about this sequence that allows this whole family of proteins to fold into this particular structure? And then in this case, the XIs are actually the identities of the amino acids. So, sequence. So that's dropping in scale. I guess if I really put these in order, this is the most microscopic. This is next. This is next. I want to remind you that you can also go up in scale. and think not about interactions among proteins or interactions among cells or interactions among amino acids, but interactions among organisms. And you're all familiar with various kinds of collective behavior in groups of organisms, the swarming of insects, the schooling of fish, the flocking of birds, and more sort of complicated things like termites building a mound. And it's useful also to think about these in the same language. So if I think about a flock of birds, what I want to do is to label every bird by the flight velocity. And then the interactions are that each bird can observe its neighbors and decide to adjust its own velocity in relation to what it sees. So in all these examples, we know that there's something that emerges from the entire network, which is not really a property of any individual element in the network. So I gave the example of the structure of the protein emerging from the entire sequence of amino acids. And there it's quite obvious that that doesn't come out of a single amino acid. That wouldn't mean anything, right? And in fact, that's a case where that's a particularly obvious case that the whole is more than the sum of the parts. Again, it's not clear what it would mean for one bird to flock, right? That's a property of the whole. We think that in order for our brain to do anything useful, it can't be that the individual neurons are all spiking and remaining silent on their own, independent of each other. Things like thoughts and memories and percepts and actions are presumably encoded by something more coordinated among all the neurons. And similarly, in a genetic network, for example, during the course of development, the state of a cell ends up being specified by the fact that this gene is expressed at this level and this other gene is expressed at another level and so on. And so the state and ultimately the fate of the cell in the course of development is a property of the network as a whole. It's very seldom, although there are famous examples, and those are important, it's generally not the case that becoming a cell of a particular type means that you turn one gene on or off. It's something that belongs, it's more distributed across the network as a whole. So these are all cases where, as I said, the whole is more than the sum of its parts, and where we think that the things that we care about biologically emerge from the interactions among a relatively large number of components. And in physics, we're used to problems like that. A lot of what we see around us is of that flavor. For example, the fact that this is solid, right, is not a property of individual atoms. It emerges from the interactions among many of them. I haven't been able, from the spectrum of questions asked in the workshop, to decide what fraction of you are physicists by education. So let me do a little bit of my physics professor job and remind you, think about taking a block of ice. Okay? Now let me take the block of ice, and I'm going to lift it 1 meter. It takes a certain amount of work to do that, right? Because I'm working against the force of gravity. You can compute how much energy that is. When you hold on to the block of ice, you're only touching the molecules at the surface. The amount of energy that it takes to lift the block of ice is more than enough to break every single bond between a molecule at the surface and the next layer of molecules. So why is it that when you lift the block of ice, you lift the entire block of ice instead of only lifting the molecules at the surface? So this is meant to, this is the opposite of my usual job. The goal here was to confuse you, right? You thought that things being solid was a very obvious fact. It's not obvious at all. Why on earth is it that when you take a block of material where every molecule or every atom basically interacts with its neighbors, and the neighbors are one angstrom away, and you take a 1 cubic centimeter block and you push on one end, the other end moves. The interactions are on the scale of angstroms, which is 10 to the minus 8 centimeters. So it's 100 million characteristic distances. Okay. So this is equivalent to taking the population of the United States. I realize the numbers are slightly different in India. You take the population of the United States and you line them up, right? And you know, you're standing in New York and you tell the person standing next to you something, and somehow the guy in Los Angeles gets the message. And we all know that that doesn't work, right? We played this game as children, and it doesn't work. And indeed, there are no one-dimensional solids, by the way. So if you actually put them in a line, it doesn't work. It's subtle, okay? In fact, there aren't. The sense in which there are two-dimensional solids is already subtle. So we're used to the idea in physics that things can emerge, non-trivial phenomena on a macroscopic scale can emerge from the interaction of large numbers of microscopic components. And the reason I belabor the point about being solid is just to remind you that some of these phenomena are so common that you really don't think about how remarkable it is that they emerge in this way from the microscopic interactions. And of course, we know that there are more subtleties than that. If I take one parameter of the water in this container and change it by, let's see, I don't know what the temperature is in here, but let's say I change this parameter by 10%, then the behavior of this stuff changes completely. Right? Because what matters is the absolute temperature. The absolute temperature is 300 Kelvin. It's not quite 30 in here, but it's 25 or so. So if I go down by 30 Kelvin, I guarantee you this will be solid. So that's a 10% change, and it produces an enormous difference in the qualitative behavior of the material. Okay, and again, that's a distinction which is a property of the large number of molecules, not the individual molecules. It doesn't mean anything to say that a small cluster of molecules is solid or liquid, right? Because faced with a small cluster of molecules, you could always push your finger through them, right? It's when you have a macroscopic collection of them that you can no longer do that. And you get the distinction between being solid and liquid. Sorry? So hang on to that thought for a moment. We'll get there. So we have, as many of you know, we have a perfectly, an extraordinarily successful language for describing these emergent phenomena in the world near to thermal equilibrium. And this is statistical mechanics, which by now is so completely mixed with field theory that they're one subject. And the fact that we have this enormously powerful language for describing emergent phenomena in inanimate systems, systems near to equilibrium, has led many people to hope that at least something, a language of the same flavor, would be equally useful in describing emergent phenomena in biological systems. And there have been lots of efforts in this direction. We've already heard talks about active matter, which is something that grew directly out of this effort. There's the use of statistical mechanics ideas in thinking about neural networks and so on. And they crop up in many places. I think it's fair to say that most of the efforts to build statistical mechanics approaches to biological networks in search of models that are analytically tractable, we've tended to move away from the reality of experiments. And moving away in the sense of abstracting is, of course, the business of theory, so that's not what you want to criticize. The problem is that if you end up with models that are sufficiently abstract, then it isn't even clear what the relationship is between the variables in the models and the variables that you measure. And then you're kind of stuck, because it's not clear even as the experiments get better, it's not clear what you do. Okay? So what I want to talk about is an effort that my colleagues and I have been making over the last decade or so to try and take a statistical mechanics approach to biological networks, which is very recognizably in the tradition of doing statistical mechanics in the abstract sense, but at the same time is grounded directly in the data that's emerging from new quantitative large-scale experiments. And the approach that I'm going to take, which is by no means unique, many of the things that we're trying to do we could do differently, and that's an interesting discussion to have. But for the purposes of today, what I would like to focus on is answering one question and one question only. You'll see that actually this is a big question, it has lots of things inside it, but really it's only one question. And that is, all of these networks, I can think about measuring the variables x sub I at one moment in time, and I could do that at another moment in time and so on, or I could think about varying things in other ways. And as I look across my many measurements, what I will find is that these variables vary randomly. And what I would like to do is to describe the probability distribution of all of the variables taken together, the joint distribution of all of the variables. So for example, in the case of protein families, if I can tell you this distribution, I can answer a whole variety of questions. One thing I can do, for example, is just to ask how many different sequences have non-zero probability, or a slightly more sophisticated version of that question, what's the entropy of this probability distribution, which tells me about the diversity of sequences that can that are consistent with being a protein in a certain class. Okay. There's also a geometry to this distribution. You might ask, does it consist in some sense of one big blob, or are there many different local maxima to the distribution? If there are many different local maxima, then you might think that the family of proteins you were describing has subfamilies. Or perhaps if you think about the case of the immune system and you're describing the diversity of antibodies, you know that ultimately some aspects of the antibody sequence are encoded in our genome, although not all of them. And so you're asking, can I find the multiple maxima of the probability distribution that betray the origins of these sequences in the things that are encoded in the genome, or have the random things that happen during recombination and somatic hypermutation been so strong that they've thoroughly mixed all of this up? You might also think that this probability distribution in the case of antibody sequences would betray something of the history of immune challenges that you've experienced, that there would be a peak, for example, surrounding the best antibody against last year's flu or something like that, right? Maybe, okay? And one can make similar arguments about all of these things. For example, in the case of a flock of birds, the most fundamental question you could ask is, if I look at the distribution of velocities, does it have a non-zero average? That is to say, are the birds in all flying in the same direction, or if I ended up describing something which is not a flock at all and is going to disperse, okay? And so on. Okay? So if I can answer this question, there's many other questions I can answer about each of these systems. The usual approach to this is to try and write down a model which describes the dynamics of how the system gets from one state to the next. So you say, well, if the concentration of proteins corresponding to this gene is a certain value, then that means that the expression level of this gene is increased because this arrow tells me something about activation. And so if I wrote down a differential equation for the concentrations of all these proteins, I'd have something in which on the right-hand side for xj, there would be some term that involved xi that had a positive slope and so on. Okay. I'm not going to do that. What I'm going to do instead is to ask if we can go directly after the distribution itself. Now, remember I said that the great example of describing emergent phenomena is equilibrium statistical mechanics. And in equilibrium statistical mechanics, this is what we do. Okay? We know the answer to this question. So for equilibrium statistical mechanics, The answer to this question is the Boltzmann distribution. And what you're supposed to do is for every possible state of the system, and remember the state is the set of all the x's, so if there are 1,000 of them, this is a 1,000 element vector, you're supposed to compute the energy, and then the probability is e to the minus energy in the right units. Now, this is a fantastic simplification, right? Because it tells you that I don't need to understand the dynamics by which the system gets to this equilibrium state. If it gets there, I know what the probability distribution is. And that probability distribution has a very special property, I think most of you know, which is that this is the solution to the problem of maximize the entropy at a fixed value of the average energy. So if you want to solve this problem, you write out the entropy. It's minus the sum of p log p. And then you introduce a Lagrange multiplier to fix the average value of the energy to be the experimental value. And you maximize this over probability distribution. You should be careful to normalize the distribution. So you add one more Lagrange multiplier. And those of you who are aficionados will recognize that this combination here is minus beta times the free energy, right? It's the average energy, there's a minus sign here, so minus the temperature, right? I pull the factor of beta out, and it 1 over beta, which is the temperature, ends up multiplying the entropy. So it's the entropy minus the temperature, the energy minus the temperature times the entropy. So this equilibrium minimizes the free energy, right? There's a minus sign, so the maximum becomes a minimum. And okay, so that's in you know, lots of thermodynamics is encoded in these few equations. But you know that entropy has another meaning, which is the Shannon sense of entropy. So Shannon asked, if I ask you a question, you tell me the answer, how much information did I gain in the process? And he proved that the only measure that will satisfy certain simple assumptions, such as the fact that if I ask you a question with two independent parts, the information should add, the only quantity which can be used as a measure of information that satisfies a small number of reasonable axioms is the entropy of the probability distribution of answers. So you can think of the entropy not in its thermodynamic sense as having something to do with heat flows, but as a measure of your uncertainty about the actual state of the system. So remember, right, the way Shannon formulated it is, how much information would I gain if I told you the actual state? So the converse of that then is, how much don't I know? Because all I have is the distribution and not the actual state. So maximizing the entropy can be thought of in a way that's totally independent of its thermodynamic meaning and corresponds to searching for probability distributions that generate states which are as random as possible. So another way of thinking about this is to say that what thermal equilibrium is a state it finds a probability distribution such that if you pull states out of that distribution, they are as random as they can be, except you know what the average energy was. And so they can't be completely random, there's a constraint. Now, this construction generalizes. What I could do is to ask, to maximize the entropy at fixed average of some function of the xi's, or maybe two functions, And what I'm doing essentially is to say, well, I don't know everything about the system, but my data are good enough that I can tell you a few facts. I can tell you that if you pick some thing, and we're going to do this concretely in a moment, but let's think about a flock of birds, which will be the first example. If I tell you the average correlation of a bird with its neighbors, that's some characteristic of the flock that I can measure actually quite accurately if I can track all the birds. And so you could say, well, could you build me, for example, a model of the probability distribution which captures that sense of ordering that every bird is correlated with its neighbors, but doesn't make any other assumptions? So other than that, you're going to let the states of the system be as random as they can be. And so this is something that, so the hope, right, if I give you a long enough list of these averages, eventually I've told you the entire distribution. So in particular, if the states of the system are discrete, then knowing the probability distribution is a list of numbers whose length is equal to the number of states, minus one, because it's normalized. So if I give you a list which is as long as the number of states, then I've told you the distribution, unless I've done something stupid and picked things that are redundant with each other, then if I simply give you a list that's that long, I've told you the entire distribution. And so the statement that I can build the maximum entropy distribution consistent with all of those things is true but useless, because I've already told you the distribution, I've just coded it in some complicated way. The hope is that I don't need to do that. That somehow I can tell you only a few things and let the maximum entropy principle, which basically says, other than the things I've told you, there's no structure, let that do the rest of the work of building the rest of the distribution. In thermal equilibrium, we know that there's only one function I need to tell you, and that's the energy, and then we're done. In general, there's no reason to think that that's true. And in fact, even that statement is already a little bit misleading, because the energy could be a very complicated function of all the microscopic variables. And so it might be natural to think, for example, that the energy is itself built out of several terms. There are different kinds of forces between molecules, or you have an interaction with your neighbor, and you have a non-zero interaction with your next nearest neighbor, and so on. Again, these are familiar to the physicists in the audience. And so if you actually try to do equilibrium statistical mechanics, there's a tendency to think that this thing called the energy is something that is written down in stone somewhere because it's the correct microscopic description of the system. That isn't actually what we do. Okay. In fact, we seldom can do that because almost all the real materials that we care about in the world are too complicated for that. They're not as complicated as biology, but they're still too complicated for that. And so we write down energy functions that have in them the things that we think are likely to be important. But in equilibrium statistical mechanics, there we have this amazing thing called the renormalization group that tells us that if we put many terms in the energy function, and we ask not about what's happening at very short distances, but what's happening macroscopically at very long distances, most of those terms don't matter. And you can set them to zero as long as you're willing to adjust the other coefficients. Okay? And so what that tells you is that even in equilibrium statistical mechanics, the success of equilibrium statistical mechanics is really the result, and any practical success, is a result of the renormalization group result that tells you that making a very short list of these functions is sufficient. And what you will observe in nature at equilibrium is the maximum entropy distribution. So for those of you who are, for whom these words mean something, the maximum entropy distribution consistent with the expectation value of all the relevant operators. And you don't need anything else. And it's the smallness of the number of relevant operators which is actually the key to success. So in the biological context, we don't know how to do this. What we're going to do is we're going to cross our fingers. And we're going to take the inspiration from the renormalization group approach to equilibrium statistical physics. Say, let's try it. Let's try and fix a small number of expectation values that we think make sense, build the maximum entropy distribution that's consistent with those, and ask whether we end up with an accurate description of the real system. Okay? Not guaranteed to work. Yes, yeah, maybe this is actually the moment at which questions tend to proliferate. So let's, yeah.
So this protocol that you talk about, is it valid for all regimes or at any special regimes? You talk of relevance or irrelevance of interactions. So is it true for all, any time at equilibrium or at certain points of time?
Sorry. So building the maximum entropy distribution that's consistent with a certain set of expectation values has absolutely nothing to do with being at equilibrium.
Okay. Right?
If you pick one expectation value, and that happens to be the thing which mechanics tells you is the energy, then you're describing thermal equilibrium. So for example, if you build the maximum entropy model that's consistent with your average interaction energy with your first neighbor, and the average interaction energy with the second neighbor, but the values that I put into the description are not the actual ones that occur in the real system, right? Then I'm describing something that is not in equilibrium. Because there should be some relationship between them that relates to the microscopic Hamiltonian. But I could fix something else, right? The system could be in a non-equilibrium state, and those two terms in the energy could have average values that don't correspond to what they would be in equilibrium, just to give one example. So it has nothing to do with being in equilibrium. Also, it's not guaranteed to work, right? I pick some set of things to fix, and I mean, we're going to do this concretely in just a moment. A lot of space here. And if I pick the wrong things, it's not going to work. So again, even if I...
How do I know a priori, though, which are the ones to take? So for example, the canonical distribution is the energy. I know for sure.
Yes, except I might not know how to write down the energy, right?
Right. So
so the statement that the energy hides a lot, right?
So what do I do? Pertaining to an energy, I count the number of states, thereby relating it to the entropy. How do I do it?
Right, entropy has a meaning for the probability distribution that has nothing to do with energies, right? It's just the sum of P log, minus the sum of P log P. Yeah, yeah. Well, then as you know, all the work is actually hiding in the thing I didn't write down, right? So, which I will not be able to suppress forever, but I was hoping to for a few minutes. Yes?
One more question, just a short one. The Ramachandran group is usually effective when you have local interactions.
Yes.
So I was just worrying about these networks of yours where I think...
Exactly. So a totally separate question is... right. So actually, this problem is going to come up. So in some of these problems, there's an obvious notion of locality. So in these two in particular, right? You might guess that amino acids interact with each other when they're close to each other in three-dimensional space, and that birds look to their neighbors, not to the bird on the other side of the flock. So in these cases, we're going to see that locality is very useful. Neurons are big. Right? They are themselves extended objects. And a typical neuron in your head takes input from 5,000 other neurons, about half of which are within its immediate neighborhood. So obviously, neighbor isn't a very useful. You know, when your coordination number is 5,000, neighbor isn't a... I mean, there might be something, but it's not so useful. So that's why I said, for the moment, let me take the normalization group argument as inspiration, and not more than that.
One question. So in development, there's this idea of morphogenetic redundancy, so that you have many, many gene and protein networks which can rise to similar morphogenetic processes and all. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't sort of point to there being a few relevant operators at the large scale?
Why don't you hold that thought? We're actually going to say something. We'll look at an embryo somewhere at the third board. Good. So let me, yes. Sorry? Well, so let me point out that you might hope that there is a microscopic description that looks like this. And for example, we heard this morning about how, you know, to what extent you can try and recover this microscopic description from observations on the states of the nodes.
So the weights, sorry.
What I'm going to do is to ask, tell me about this probability distribution. Now, if you look at this probability distribution, it may have a form, for example, once you look at the probability distribution and you think, oh, it's kind of like statistical mechanics, so I take the log and the thing in it is an energy, and I see a term xi times xj with some coefficient. So I'm tempted to think that that coefficient lives on this arrow. I don't know how to show that that's true. In fact, I'm pretty sure that in general it's not. So that's the assumption that you're in thermal equilibrium, right? In thermal equilibrium, that's actually true. You have to be a little careful about exactly what you mean, but a statement of that flavor is exactly true. That is to say, if you write down dynamical equations, the coefficients in the dynamical equations end up in this exponential without any corrections. In general, that's not true. So the relationship between describing the distribution and this model with arrows is not simple at all. And that's part of the reason why I'm suggesting that since the answers to many questions are contained in the distribution itself, we should try and construct the distribution rather than building a model of this form, taking this model, calculating the distribution in this model, and then seeing whether it matches the data. What I'm going to do is I'm going to look to the data and see if it can help me construct this distribution directly. And what I hope to convince you by the end of next half hour is that these distributions that we see from that driven from the real data, first of all, that I can write down distributions that really are very good approximations to the real data, which is by no means obvious. And I must say, I'm not quite sure I understand why it works. And then that those distributions have surprising properties, and that those are the things, in some sense, that we would like to try and understand, maybe by reference to a more microscopic model. Okay, so let's talk about birds. So I should imagine that there's one bird that I'm focused on. He's bird I, and he's surrounded by other birds in his neighborhood, typical birds J. And the arrows that I'm drawing are the velocities with which he's flying. So how do I think I should characterize this flock? Well, let's see if I can reassemble this. Very good, thanks. I'm going to try and characterize the flock with, again, a small number of quantities. So let me take, for example, the similarity to neighbors. So what can I do? I can take the velocity with which the bird I'm looking at is flying and compare that to the average I'm going to draw some neighborhood here, n sub I, and it's basically going to be the nearest neighbors. Not one nearest neighbor, but some number of them, maybe 10. I mean, we can discuss how you set that number. That's a very small part of the problem. And I can measure the similarity of one bird to the average of all of its neighbors. I should really measure that in some units. So I get a dimensionless measure. And then if I want to, I can average over the entire flock. And so let's call the expectation value of that Q. And I'd like to build a model of the flock in which this similarity of every bird to its the average of its neighbors comes out right. So that's one of the functions that I want to fix. So I can do this in two different ways. One way to do it is to say that you're a neighbor if you're within distance r. Another way to do it is to say that you're a neighbor if you're one of the n sub c nearest guys. Okay. So what I can tell you, so this is really, so let me back up a bit. The reason that I'm able to do what I'm going to do in the next few minutes is because my colleagues Andrea Cavagna and Irene Giardina in Rome did this fantastic thing of building the tools to actually track individual starlings in a flock of order 1,000 as they fly by and do their aerial displays over the piazza in front of the train station in Rome. I mean, the tools aren't specific to that setting, but that is where they actually did the experiment, which, by the way, involved setting up the cameras on the building that has the best view is a museum, which means you need permission from a different ministry in order to get on top of it. Anyhow, it's there's a lot that goes into making these experiments work, not just science. So one of the things that they showed early on is that the correlation behaviors in the flock are much more consistent with each bird interacting with a fixed number of neighbors rather than all the birds within a fixed distance. What I'm going to tell you is that if you do the exercise that I'm describing for you, you can always figure out how to define the size of the neighborhood, right? You're trying to build a model of the probability distribution. So at the end of the day, you can determine the size of the neighborhood by maximum likelihood, right? It's a parameter. If you do that with a fixed distance, then when you analyze flocks that are of different density, you find that the distance varies with the density. If you do the analysis on the assumption that you interact with a fixed number of neighbors, then you find that that number of neighbors is independent of the density. Needless to say, the variation of radius with density is such that you capture a fixed number of neighbors. Within a single flock, it's not that important, because if you don't watch it for too long, because the density is reasonably uniform inside the flock. And so you don't notice the difference between fixed distance and fixed number until you either look at the same flock very far away in time, when it can expand and contract, or you just look at a different flock that happens to be flying at a different density. I'm sorry? Yes. Excellent question. One of the reasons why you have to hope that it's only a small number of quantities that you need to estimate is that then you can keep control over the errors. As you know, if you try to estimate a very large number of quantities, even if the error bar on one of them is very small, in some sense, the volume in the space of all of them may be actually still quite large. I mean, you can say that in different ways. The famous example is just trying to estimate a correlation matrix, right, of high-dimensional data. So there are errors. I can't pull up from memory the error bars on these quantities in the case of the flock of birds. They're small. I mean, in fact, the truth is that you can measure this expectation value in one snapshot. And the variation from snapshot to snapshot is already very small. And the variation from flock to flock is a little bit bigger, but not much. So these are very well determined quantities. So that's one thing you could fix. You'll notice that if you boost every bird by a fixed velocity, this quantity is invariant. So if this is the only thing you fix, you haven't actually told me how fast the flock is flying. So I better fix a couple of other things. For example, I might want to fix just the average speed. And let's assume that I don't care. I'm going to treat all the birds identically. So that's another one. I don't know, let's call that S. Actually, let's call it V0. And so then it'll be the same V0 here, and that'll set natural units. And then you might also worry that you know, birds can change their velocity both because they look to their neighbors and because they just, for example, might have a speed at which they want to fly. So it's not that they're trying to fly at the same speed as their neighbors. They're each individually trying to fly at 5 meters per second. Right? So we should also keep track of something that's related to the variance of the speed, not in relation to my neighbors, but just straightforwardly the variance, which is equivalent to saying that you should also keep track of this quantity. Let's put V0 squared out here just to get the units. So we'll get one more sigma squared. And this, of course, you really don't need because it just sets the units, right, of velocity. So really, you're fixing two quantities. And I told you that this construction generalizes. The generalization is that instead of having e to the minus, right, you're fixing the average energy, so you get e to the minus energy times a Lagrange multiplier, which in the equilibrium case has a name. It's called the temperature, but just a name. Don't let that fool you. The answer to all of this is that the probability distribution looks like a sum of terms and the number of terms is exactly the number of expectation values that you have. And so the first thing you have to do is to analyze this family of models and find the values of g, in this case g1 and I guess g3, that are consistent with the observed expectation values. So this is the reverse of what we usually do in statistical mechanics. In statistical mechanics, for example, I usually know what the energy function is. I fix the temperature and compute the average value of the energy. Here I'm actually taking seriously this inverse formulation, and so I'm telling you the average value of the energy. You have to figure out where to set the temperature so that it comes out right. Except it's a little more complicated than that because there's several things that you have to fix. In this case, just two. Yes? Yes, right, exactly. So So let me expand that a little bit. If you think that you have a set of independent observations on the data, then the equations which, so if you have a collection of independent observations of the state x, then the equations that you are solving to set g, to fix the g's so that the expectation values come out right, are exactly the maximum likelihood equations. So there's this intimate connection between the sort of thermodynamic identities and the statement of maximum likelihood. If we were doing equilibrium statistical mechanics, of course, there would be. So you might try to take that interpretation and see where it gets you, but you should be careful. Because we're not doing equilibrium statistical mechanics. OK, so yes?
Suppose I'm given a microscopic model.
Yes?
Like Vijay model. Are you guaranteed that you would get
no
this probability distance?
Yeah. No. No. So you do this. The first question is it right? That is to say, are the things that I've fixed sufficient Remember, you're building a model which is as random as it can be, except that these expectation values have to come out right. So you're fixing a very small number of things, and you'll notice you're fixing quantities which are local in space. So what you could do is to try and compute some, and by the way, once you fix these, the probability distribution is determined. So now anything else that you calculate is a prediction. There's no fitting, right? We're done. So let's remember that a velocity can be thought of as a speed and a unit vector. And we can compute, for example, so this is the similarity with your neighbors, but we could think about computing similarities or correlations. So for example, let me compute the correlation function, the directional fluctuations. So how do I do that? I take the direction in which every bird is flying, I subtract the average direction in which the bird, in which the flock is flying. This defines, actually let me put a k here, this defines a fluctuation in the direction of bird I. And so what I can do is to take the average of delta s at bird I and delta s at bird j, and I can average over all the birds that are separated by a distance r. And if I do that, what I find is experimentally a remarkably featureless result, which basically tells you that the correlations extend over all distances, right? There's no obvious scale at which this thing breaks. If you try to define a scale by picking the point at which this crosses zero and call that the correlation length, then you can do the same analysis with many different flocks, and flocks come in different sizes. So you can ask, how does this relate to the size of the flock? You just measure its linear dimensions. What you discover is that it's proportional to the size of the flock, which tells you that really there is no scale here. And you could ask, well, what happens in the model? What does the model predict? Well, the model essentially does something like that. They lie perfectly on top of each other. Remember that the thing that you have fixed is the average of the correlations with your neighbors, but this is the size of your neighborhood. So the fact that you get this right is not surprising, because that's what you fixed, although the relationship's a little bit complicated. But this is a distance measured in a couple of meters, whereas the flock is 30 meters across, and you get all the structure right. You can do the same thing for the correlations in speed. Or delta VI, delta VJ, at RIJ equal to R. And actually, somewhat disturbingly, you get a curve that looks almost the same. Okay? And the same result about Xi. Okay? And you also reproduce, the theory reproduces this as well. When you take a snapshot of the flock, you know where all the birds are. You define neighborhood by this business of counting the guys who are nearest to you. Okay? So I give you the positions of the birds, and you're calculating for me the distribution of velocities. Okay? So in some sense, the graph that lies underneath this is given to you by the positions. Right? So that's where you get R. Sorry, I should have made that clearer at the beginning. You can do better than this, actually. Suppose you have four birds. Okay, two pairs that are separated by R. And you can ask, if I measure the correlation between these two birds, so 1, 2, 3, and 4, and it's a little bit bigger than the expected correlation for two birds that are separated by R, is that correlated with the other pair? And you can average over all the pairs that are a distance capital R apart. So this is a four-point function for the cognoscenti. And you get this right too. And the reason this is surprising is that these are incredibly small effects, but you get them right. Okay. So you can keep going. You can compute more things if you want to. But what this shows you is that the model you've written down gives you a surprisingly accurate description of the behavior on scales out to the size of the flock. It gives you a description of four bird correlations when the only things that you kept track of really involved pairs of birds, right? Because you can rewrite this in terms of pairs. You've really fixed very little, and yet you get this very accurate description of the system as a whole. Furthermore, this description and the data have a very surprising property, which is that they are, choose your favorite buzzword, the correlation length is the size of the system is scale-free, you have long-range correlations, right? It's this behavior of essentially featureless functions of distance for the correlation functions, and if you tried to find a feature, you would find that that length scale was basically the size of the system. Okay? There is no intrinsic length scale here. So how is this possible? Remember, you're insisting that the system, you're only matching the behavior of the correlations between individual birds and their neighbors. So I'm telling you something about your correlation with your neighbors, and yet somehow this translates into correlations that extend over the entire system. So this model, when you fix these functions, is an equilibrium statistical mechanics problem with local interactions. Didn't have to be, but it is. And we know that in that large class of models, the only way that you can have long-range, actually there are only two ways to have long-range correlations. One is if you break a continuous symmetry, there's Goldstone's theorem that tells you that you'll have long-range correlations. So as my colleague Andrea Cavagna likes to say, this graph is evidence that the birds know Goldstone's theorem. There is a breaking of a continuous symmetry. They fly in this direction and not that direction. And associated with that symmetry breaking, this model has a Goldstone mode, in fact, two of them, right? The two directions perpendicular to the flight direction. And the long-range correlations here arise from the Goldstone modes in the usual way. Okay? The selection of a velocity of an average speed is not the breaking of a continuous symmetry. Neither in the model we write down nor in real life are all speeds equivalent to each other. And thus, you cannot appeal to Goldstone's theorem to explain this. The only way to get this out of a model of this general flavor is if the parameters of the model have been tuned to a critical point. And indeed, the coefficient that fixes sigma squared, if you vary that coefficient, what you discover is that if you move away from the value that actually fits the, that matches the observed value of sigma squared, then this correlation function develops a curvature which corresponds to a finite correlation length. So one way of thinking about it is if you imagine the hypothetical flock that had a different value for the variance of the speed, then as you move that, in particular, as you make that smaller, so that every bird has a greater tendency to fly at its own defined speed, then you move away from this critical behavior and develop a finite correlation length. As you increase that, that variance in speed, you move toward criticality. The system is finite, so there's a limit to how much we can say. But if you take the model seriously, then what would happen is the only way to get a bigger value of the speed variance than what you actually see would be for the flock to bifurcate into some birds that were flying faster than others and the distribution became bimodal, and of course that wouldn't be a flock at all. So this is this critical point in this family of models is at the edge of what's possible for a flock. It actually defines also a border for what makes sense biologically. So there are two results here then. One is that by fixing a small number of expectation values, I'm able to produce a model for the statistical structure of the flock as a whole, which is surprisingly successful. And that the reason that that works is because, and so where works means reproduce the observed long-range correlations, is that the parameters of the model, which of course are entirely determined by the experimental expectation values, are tuned very close to a critical point. Okay. And in this case, we're using the intuition that we have from equilibrium statistical mechanics with local interactions, right? Where the sign of criticality is the diverging of a correlation length. So let me switch gears for a moment. Sure.
So you calibrated this against starlings. What about other birds?
Where are the data? So one of the problems, this is really something that deserves a larger discussion. Maybe the way to do it is the following. There are different communities that have come to making measurements on biological systems. I think and so I'm going to be cartoonish about the communities, and I hope not to offend anybody unnecessarily. I think physicists have a drive for simplification and reduction that leads them to try and do experiments in which they measure a small number of things very, very carefully. Often they make the number of things they measure small by isolating the thing they're measuring from everything else. So the epitome of this are people who do single molecule experiments, right, in biophysics. On the other hand, there is a strain of quantitative biology that says the way to move beyond where we've been in the past is to measure many things at once. So let's try and survey, let's try and measure not the expression level of one gene, but let's survey expression levels across the entire genome. And in the same way that the physics community can become a little obsessive about the precision of measuring one thing, forgetting that the one thing they're measuring is in a much larger context, and maybe they need to think about that, the community of people who focus on trying to measure many things at once can forget that sometimes it really does matter how well you measure each thing. Okay? So you can't do this. The construction I'm talking about relies on being able to measure many things simultaneously, but really being able to trust each of the individual measurements. The number of cases in which that's been done is relatively small. Okay. And I think there's a huge experimental opportunity there. So that's a long version of the, I need another example. You're right, of course. I'm going to tell you about a finite set of examples. If I'm not careful, I'm only going to tell you about one. So let me go on. Yes? Yes. So let me be clear about this. This is also related to the question that Carolyn asked. You might have other reasons to decide that you like this model. Okay. So I don't know. So one view is, so for instance, I think a common view in computer science is that when I write down probabilistic models, I measure the quality of the model in relation to the efficiency of the algorithm for learning its parameters. I don't like writing down models where it's hard to learn the parameters. Actually, this is a terrible choice from that point of view. These models are hard to learn, in general. In certain approximate cases, I mean, there's a whole industry of making approximations, but in general, they're hard to learn. And we can talk about that, but let me try to get through more. Once you've motivated the model, then after that, you know, what you're really doing is just maximum likelihood. So the only thing that is, the only content of the appeal to maximum entropy is that, first of all, there's a kind of formal thing that this reminds you of what you're doing in statistical equilibrium statistical mechanics, and many of the identities that you can prove in the statistical mechanics context are useful at various stages along the line. Approximation schemes that you know about from statistical mechanics can be applied, and so on. So there's that, but that's sort of internal, right? That doesn't really say anything about what's going on about nature, right? That's mathematical. The statement about nature is that you are really asking, what are the minimal consequences of your observation that this quantity is equal to Q and this quantity is equal to sigma squared? Right? Because I'm asking you to build a model which matches those values, which you got from the data, but otherwise generate states that are as random as they can be. Okay? So that's the intuitive power. After that, you could say, look, I'm writing down a model, and you know, anybody's family of models is as good as anybody else's.
Question.
Well, you can construct a probability distribution, whether it will turn out to do as well. By the way, notice that we're not fixing a function Q, we're fixing a number, right? It's averaged over the neighbors out to some distance, that's it, right? With C4, you'd have to tell me exactly what you were going to do, right? I mean, you pick the value at the shortest distance, the longest distance. Yes. So the intuition, which I guess I should have picked up more strongly, is that birds look to their neighbors and not to things that are very far away. So that fundamentally, the ordering in the system should be characterized by the strength of your correlation with your neighbors. That's an intuition, which can be wrong, but that's the intuition. And why do you pick something which is essentially pairwise? Well, because that's the simplest thing. But these are, in general, these are only intuitions. Once I tell you that you end up with a model that's in a family that corresponds to equilibrium statistical mechanics, what I can tell you is that if what you cared about is out here rather than in here, then I actually know that I don't need anything else. Yes.
Often in statistical mechanics, symmetry is a guiding factor in one's ability to write down the free energy function.
Yes.
Is there an analogous thing here?
Well,
you know, like
I did try to pick things that are rotationally invariant, right?
So that is one.
Weak. It's weak.
One thing.
And we're going to lose it in just a minute.
So, but for example, you know, there's a flock of birds where there's a bird leading the entire flock.
Yes.
Then what are the kinds of things you
Well, maybe the most important symmetry here is that we treat all the birds identically, which is probably wrong.
Then how does it make sense to?
Well, it worked, right? The strength of the size of our error must not be very big. That doesn't mean that what I say is true. It just means that the size of the mistake I'm making for the quantities that I chose to compare is small. And this, by the way, is really important, right? Maybe this is the most important lesson of the renormalization group in statistical mechanics. The way in which you correctly calculate macroscopic behavior is not by getting every microscopic detail right. It's by getting right those features of the microscopics which matter for the questions that you're going to ask. And there's this, the miracle of the renormalization group is that there is a set of quantities you can measure which are completely insulated from mistakes that you make on a different scale. Okay? Now, there's no reason to believe that, let me put it this way. I don't know how to make that argument more generally. Right? I can't give you an argument for an enormous class of networks that plausibly includes things that are realistic models of biology, that something like that should be true. So that's why I say one takes it as inspiration, you try it, and you see how well it works. Can I try to do a little bit more? And then we'll, I think this is set so that we'll have a little bit of time. Okay. So in protein families, as we said, the XIs are basically amino acid identities. So if I look at the set, I'm basically looking at amino acid sequences. So for example, I can have XI alpha is 1 if the amino acid at site I is of type alpha and 0 otherwise. So if I look at this, it's the probability of using alpha at I. And if I look at that, that tells me about correlated substitutions. Okay? So I look across a large family. I can look at a single site. I look at amino acid number 37. And I ask, how often is it an arginine? How often is it a lysine? And so on. That's these numbers. And I can also ask, if I look at amino acid number 37 and amino acid number 43, when this one is an arginine, how often is this one a tyrosine, and so on. You realize that if a protein is 100 plus amino acids long, and there are 20 different kinds of amino acids, this is a lot of numbers, and you might be worried about whether you can really measure them from the available data, and you'd be right. And that's a whole discussion we could have. Okay? But let me characterize what's been going on in the field. So a number of years ago, Rama Ranganathan and his group in Dallas started doing a really interesting series of experiments in which they looked at a particular family of small proteins, about 40 amino acids long. And what they did was to try and generate, they took a large family in the sense that there are many members in the family, but the sequences are relatively short. And they tried to generate synthetic families which matched either just this statistic, which is easy to do, right? You just, at every site, you pick at random from the proteins, and this one, which is harder to do. But they developed a strategy, a numerical strategy for doing it. And then they did the thing that was really wonderful, which was they actually took sequences out of their synthetic family and made them and asked whether they folded and gave them functional behavior. And if you match only the one-body statistics, then you never find a functional protein. But if you match also the two-body statistics, then about half or two-thirds of the proteins that you make actually work. Which is pretty extraordinary, because it suggests that maybe the two-body the pairwise statistics are enough to characterize, basically allow you to build a distribution of sequences that when you draw out of it, with reasonable probability, you get something that's a real protein that belongs to the family. So what we did was to show that the algorithm that Ranganathan and company were using in a certain limit is maximum entropy consistent with these objects, which I think was not obvious at the time. And since then, many people have been trying to use these maximum entropy models to describe different sequence families. And if you ask, what is the maximum entropy model that's consistent with these statistics, then the answer is that it looks like if you want, Potts spins in an external field with pairwise interactions. Now, remember that the protein is, right, you're describing amino acids along a chain. The chain folds up into three-dimensional space. If you take the equivalence of this to equilibrium statistical mechanics seriously, you might guess that substitutions, or even if you don't worry about the formal equivalence, you just think in a kind of intuitive way, you might guess that if I have an amino acid sitting here and another amino acid sitting over here, if I change this one, it doesn't really directly affect the choice that I should make over here. On the other hand, if I have two amino acids that are very close to each other, then, for example, if I make this one a little bigger, I probably have to make this one a little smaller in order to maintain packing. If I try to make the charge on this one positive, I better make the charge on this one negative. And so you might suspect that these interactions, if you want the patterns of conditional dependency that Caroline was talking about this morning, that these would be local in three dimensions, not local in the index I, which is measured along the polypeptide chain, but local in three dimensions. So if that's true, then if I have a big enough family of sequences that I can actually measure these things accurately, then when I construct this model, I will find that the J's are large only for things that are spatially near each other. And that would mean that the statistical correlations in the pattern of amino acid substitutions in the family encodes information about the three-dimensional structure of the protein. And if this really worked, it would mean that I could fold the protein by looking not at one sequence, but by looking at the family of sequences. And so there are several papers that, starting with examples of two proteins, families of pairs of proteins that interact with each other, where they try to identify the contact surface by this sort of argument, and then looking at individual globular proteins and arguing that although this whole process is approximate, it's approximate because there's a finite amount of data, and so you don't really measure these things so accurately. It's approximate because the approximations that they use in trying to build the models are a little shaky, but that the things that come out of it are good enough that maybe with a little help from other techniques, you can determine the three-dimensional structure of the molecule, which is an amazing idea. Okay, so this has focused a lot of attention on the use of these models. One of the things that I think is important to remember is that they still haven't, except for those very early experiments from Ranganathan, they haven't actually passed tests like this one, where you really calculate something from the model that is a prediction about the statistical structure of the family and show that it's correct, right? Well, they go from some statistical features to the model, and then they try to prune the model down to a limited number of interactions, and then from that they try to construct the structure of the molecule and say, we did pretty well. And the question of whether the model that you have as an intermediate step is really a good model of the distribution of sequences has sort of fallen by the wayside, which I think is unfortunate because that's a really important question, right? Let me, yes? No. They need not be, no.
So once we know, let's say given these ideas, I mean, we know the role of the protein in various networks, like gene expression,
yes,
say signal transduction. So we know what it and cat, say enzyme.
Yes.
What reactions it catalyzes. So let's say we know the roles, different roles. Then it will throw light on its 3D structure also, right?
Yes. So here the argument is that the three-dimensional structural information is somehow contained in the statistical structure of the sequences alone.
No, not now, that. The role it plays in various other things. I mean,
the connect. So look, all the things I'm telling you have connections outward to many things. I want to try and focus just on this part. Okay. So yes. Look, the way in which you defined the family in the first place had to do with its functional role, right? You found all the kinases of a certain family of protein kinases or something like that, or a certain family of enzymes and so on. So you've already used that in defining the class. What you're asking about is what is the diversity of sequences that are consistent with being a member of that class?
So you're not looking at the transduction and other. Or you've already taken that into account while constructing the family?
When you construct the family, precisely.
Yeah, just one similar. So does this, just to understand, does this say that if you have a family of proteins having similar function, and if you know their 3D structure, you could predict some property of another protein having the similar function?
Maybe. Let me make one more observation here, which is very important, okay? Which is not unrelated to the question that you're asking. If it's really true that these things are completely local, then normally you would then expect that the correlations would also be short-ranged. And then in that case, I don't need to do this complicated thing. What I should do is just measure correlation between amino acid substitutions, so something like this. And if I did it as a function of distance, right, I would find, well, maybe it's different for different things, but I would find something that looked like this. And so if I put a threshold here, I would automatically pick out all of the amino acids that were reasonably close to each other, and that would be all I needed to know. And in fact, people considered that possibility a long time ago, and it doesn't work. In fact, if you draw this, it looks like this. Right? To the extent that the correlations decay, they decay very slowly and persist out to very long distances. The neighbor distance is again something like this. So if it's really going to be true that a model with local interactions reproduces the correlations that you see, then since the correlations are long-ranged, something special must be going on. Okay. Now, the problem is that proteins are not infinitely large, right? So, and they have complicated paths through them. So you can't quite say what you would like to say. But let me emphasize that if you just make these plots of correlation versus distance, they don't decay, right? And so if a model like this with purely local interactions is going to work, which we still don't really know, then the only way it can work is if the strength of these interactions is tuned close to a critical point.
The number of components is rather small, so the fluctuation.
Exactly. So this is. I give this to you as an example. One of the way in which people are using these maximum entropy methods to try and get at a larger set of questions about structure, but also as another example where you're seeing hints of something that if you take these models seriously, at least in certain limits, it would be very hard to understand how that works. And so if it's true, it's pointing you to something very special about the structure of these or the parameters in these distributions. So we don't know yet whether that's true. But this is also a case where our intuition about locality is very strong. Okay? I was going to try and say something about genetic networks, but I'm already running beyond the time that I should take. So let me close by saying a few words about neural networks. And tomorrow, when I talk about information flow in networks, I'll focus more on genetic networks, and maybe we can say I can fill in a few of the things that I skipped here. So let me skip to talking about neural networks. And here, the idea is going to be very similar. If I told you the expectation value of xi, that's the problem. Remember that xi is a binary variable, 1 if the neuron generated a spike and 0 if it remained silent. So this is the probability that the neuron spikes in a small window of time that you're looking at. And then this, well, you should subtract the averages, but these are the pairwise correlations. And you could think about fixing other quantities. For example, you could ask, what's the probability that out of the n neurons in the system, k of them happen to be spiking at once? You'll notice that there are n of these, and there are n of these, but there are n squared of those. Well, n times n minus 1 over 2. And so this, you know, if you're willing to fix this is almost free, right? It's not, there aren't too many of them. But anyhow, it's the same idea. You're going to try and write down a model that describes the probability distribution for the joint activity of all the neurons at once, and you're going to do it by focusing on this limited number of things to start out with. And we started doing this in collaboration with my colleague Michael Berry at Princeton, who works on the retina, which is the ideal starting place for the very simple reason that the retina is flat. Actually, not quite, right? It's curved, but relatively flat. So that means you take the retina out, the array of neurons that are projecting out of the retina can be placed flat on an array of electrodes. And so this was the first place where people succeeded in recording from many neurons simultaneously, because you make a large array of electrodes, you put the tissue down on it, and, well, there's still a lot of things you have to get right, but that's a lot easier than trying to dive into a three-dimensional dense network, right? And so when we started, we were looking at data where you perhaps had a dozen neurons recorded simultaneously in a small patch. And by now, Michael and his colleagues are able to record from essentially all of the neurons that are responsible for encoding a small patch of the visual world whose radius is the radius that can be reached by a single neuron, okay? Because the neurons are extended objects. So this is of order 150 or 200 neurons. And so what we do is we build these maximum entropy models that are consistent with these quantities. And the thing that you need to know is that when you look in this small patch of the retina, and indeed when you look in a small region, any small region of the brain, pairwise correlations are actually quite weak. So if you turn these into correlation coefficients, then a correlation coefficient of 10% is actually huge for any single pair of cells. However, almost every pair of cells has a significantly non-zero correlation that you can measure. So there's a distribution of these correlation coefficients which is peaked near zero, but doesn't have a singularity at zero, right? And these experiments, remember the natural time scale is tens of milliseconds. These experiments last for hours. So you have an enormous number of samples. The threshold for significance is very, very small. Okay. And the distribution of correlation coefficients is essentially continuous. Okay? There are no zero correlation coefficients. Or at least there aren't any more than expected from a continuous distribution. So when you do this, you build a model. And again, what we'd like to do is something like this. You have to check something to see that your model is correct. So what do you do? Well, if it's a small number of neurons, just compute the probability of every single state. So if you have 10 neurons, there's only 1,024 states. Compute the probability of every one of them. Over an hour, you can just count and see whether you got it right. And you do. By the time you get to 100 neurons, you can't do this anymore, of course. And so you have to start computing other things. The most interesting thing is that, of course, these models, when you're done, you can think of the probability as being like e to the minus an energy, right? You could compute the log probability. So what that means is that the model assigns to every state, a possible state of the system, an energy or a log probability, if the states are actually drawn out of the model, then that energy will have a certain distribution. But of course, you could also look at the states that are actually seen in the data and compute the distribution and ask whether those are the same. And the answer is that they match each other very precisely out to values of the energy or log probability that correspond to events that should happen once per year. So you might think, what are these doing in our analysis? And the answer, of course, is that we have no idea what the probability of any one of those events is. However, we know how many of them there should be, right? So you can ask, you know, any one of those events shouldn't happen very often, but there are lots of them. And so what you're counting in is the trade-off between the frequency of individual events and the numerosity of those events. And that comes out right deep into the tail of events. Okay? Why is that quantity so interesting? That quantity is so interesting because it's something that you may recognize from statistical mechanics. So when you do statistical mechanics, and this is going to take me 2 minutes and then I'll be done. When you want to compute the partition function, remember that you sum over states e to the minus beta times the energy. So you all know that you can rewrite this as an integral over energies. Like this. And in fact, if you want to, you can even integrate by parts and put a step function here, right, instead of the delta function. This is a number of states that are have energy less than E. Since it's a number of states, you can take its logarithm and you get an entropy. This is the microcanonical entropy. And that means that the partition function is really that, which you all probably remember. And since energy and entropy are both extensive quantities, it's natural to pull out a factor of n. Right? And then you know that you'll be dominated by the state that has minimum free energy. If there's a thermodynamic limit, it exists because the limit as n becomes large of 1 over n s evaluated at E equals epsilon times n is actually a function of epsilon. And if this function exists, then you have a thermodynamic limit, and so on, right? So if you count states that have a certain probability, or have probability greater than a certain amount, what you're doing is mapping the energy entropy as a function of energy. So we can do this, actually, we can try doing this directly from the data. Of course, that's not going to work terribly well because there are lots and lots of states and we can't measure them very well. But we can try and get as far as we can. Certainly, if n isn't too big, you can do well. And then from the models that we produce, which, as I say, match this distribution reasonably well, we can try and extract the same quantity. And what you get is that as you go to larger and larger groups of neurons, things start to converge with order percent accuracy on a simple straight line. And what's amazing is that we've seen this not only in the retina, we've also started to look at data coming from a completely different network, namely the network of cells in the hippocampus of a rodent, which is responsible for encoding place and so on, very deep inside the brain as opposed to being at the input. And we see essentially the same thing, although it's much more preliminary because it's our first pass through the data. The statement that you are dominated by states of minimum free energy is the statement, right, that you should take the derivative of this quantity with respect to the energy and set it equal to zero. That corresponds to the definition of temperature as the inverse of dSdE. What you're doing when you make that statement is a saddle point approximation to the integral at large n. That saddle point is enforced by the non-zero value of the second derivative of the entropy. If that should vanish, then you're at a critical point, which corresponds to the divergence of the specific heat. Okay. This is a purely thermodynamic notion of criticality that has nothing to do with correlation lengths, nothing to do with the locality of interactions. Remember that systems with non-local interactions can also have critical points. There is no, there's no temperature here, right? It might as well be one. And so the typical state that you would pick out would be the place where dSdE equals one. And the sign of criticality would be the vanishing of the second derivative. What we see is that dSdE is equal to one within errors across the entire range of E that we have access to. So the system that we're describing is at a very strange kind of critical point. Okay? So some sort of infinite, it's not infinite order in the sense that you have to move, not in the sense, in the sequence from first order, second order, third order, but infinite order in the sense that all of the derivatives of the entropy with respect to the energy seem to be vanishing, at least over some finite range. Okay? So I've gone on too long, and I want to summarize. There's been a revolution in our ability to make measurements on these systems. It's not so long ago that making a measurement on neurons meant spending 15 minutes with one neuron. Okay. And now you can spend an afternoon with 150 neurons, and very soon that number will be 1,000. And 10 years from now, that number is going to be 10,000. Okay. Similarly, we used to know about handfuls of sequences. We now know about thousands of them. It used to be that quantitative measurements on flocks and swarms and schools, quantitative measurements were limited to watching a dozen fish in a tank. Okay? And now you can track 1,000 birds at once. Okay? The fact that we can now observe precisely the behavior of very large numbers of elements in these networks means that we can no longer get away with our theoretical descriptions of these networks being metaphorical. Okay? If we want to do the statistical mechanics of flocks of birds, then this may not be the right way to do it, but you do have to confront these data. You can't any longer write down something that you say, well, you know, it's kind of like the real system, and I get some qualitative things right, and then I go off and I don't worry. There are now enormous bodies of quantitative experiments that you have to compare against. What I've given you is one strategy for doing that, in which you take from the data a small number of things that your intuition suggests should be characteristic of the system. And of course, being your intuition, it can be wrong. And from that small set of things, you try to build a model that's supposed to describe everything about the distribution. And then you can check and see how well you do. We've been surprised by the success of this strategy in a range of different systems. And in each case, I can assure you that there are very good reasons why it shouldn't work, many of which were pointed out to us by referees. And a few less official critics. The fact that it does seem to work at least tells you that there's a strategy, doesn't mean this is the right one, for going from the state of measurements today to good approximations to the whole distribution. And being able to look at that distribution and calculate things from it with confidence that you have a reasonably good approximation is a wonderful thing to be able to do because it links back to all sorts of questions. I've hardly scratched the surface of the kinds of things you might want to ask about, but maybe this tantalizing connection to protein structure is the one that's attracted the most attention. it's attractive that it's the same mathematical strategy that we're using in all of these different systems. So that means that things that we learn in one case might help us think about others. And then, since these models are models of the statistical mechanics flavor, we know that as the number of degrees of freedom becomes large, the space of those models breaks up into a phase diagram, in which certain parts of the parameter space have one qualitative behavior, other parts have a different qualitative behavior, and there are critical surfaces that separate these different regions. So usually we think of constructing that phase diagram from a model, whereas in this case what we're doing is constructing it from, you know, from a microscopic model. Here we're constructing it in a sense from a phenomenological class of models, and indeed we could replace the axes not with the parameters of the model, but with the expectation values that we observe in the real system. And so that suggests that there's a strategy for placing the networks that we see in nature on a phase diagram of possible networks. The surprising thing is that many of these systems seem to be sitting near the critical surfaces. And if that's true, then it's a hint of something much deeper. If it's not true, I think this is still interesting, because getting your hands on the probability distribution is a really important thing to do. So the question clearly cuts across these many different systems. If the answer does too, then we will have really discovered something. So let me stop there and thank you for your patience. No.
Okay, one more time.
Oh, in fact, you know, I mean, if people who need to leave want to leave, and anyone want to stay and do it at the board, that's fine. If you want to do it, I guess there is no alcohol, right? So that's not
no.
Okay.
So I have a question.
Okay. So anybody who wants to leave and you need to go.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Okay. So I was going to ask you about this last comment of yours. Is there any insight why you're always landing up near critical points? I mean, it's amazing.
So the idea that biological networks might be near criticality is a very old idea. And I think that, so you can go back to the late 1960s with papers by Stuart Kaufman about random Boolean networks as models for genetic networks and arguments as to why it would be useful if the system were near the critical point between being stable and being chaotic. I think that if I try to characterize the history of the discussion, it very quickly became ideological. Of course, this was at a time where the data really weren't very good. And so people started to promote arguments for why it made sense for biological systems to be near criticality to, you know, almost, it has to be that way. So, you know, if I think about a neural network, if I go too far in one direction, it becomes epileptic. If I go too far in the other direction, you flatline, right, and you're dead. The thing in between is a critical point, you should sit there. Well, no, the correct statement is you don't want to sit at either end, but really there's a lot of space in between, and the critical point is just one place on the axis in between, and in any case, this isn't a line. It's a much bigger space. So every possible argument for why you might want to be critical in this sense, and of course this isn't the only notion of criticality one can think about, you can think about dynamical ones instead of statistical ones, almost every possible argument for why this is a good idea has been made somewhere in the literature. And following that argument, there's a school of people who are so convinced by that they're sure that it must be true, and the evidence that they hold up is proportional, you know, is weak in proportion to the strength of their belief, right? Mm-hmm. So they're doing a proper Bayesian computation. If you have a very strong prior, you don't need very much data to convince you that you're right, which is the wrong way to do a Bayesian computation, but nonetheless. If we now say, okay, look, let's take seriously the hint from all of these data that you're close to criticality. Every one of these things has its problems, right? And so we could go into that. The difficulty is that at the critical point, as you know, many quantities are either at their maximum or their minimum. And the whole point of our understanding of critical phenomena is that those are all tied together. So I don't know how, you know, how do I tell which is the one that biology really cared about that provided the evolutionary pressure to push you to this point in the critical surface? I don't know, because if I move toward the critical surface, all these things happen at once. So I don't know which was the one that was important. By the way, in almost every example that we know about, right, this kind of criticality is also associated with critical slowing down, which means that if this is correct, right, all of these systems will exhibit in their dynamics a very wide range of timescales. So for example, in the case of neurons, I could give you an argument for criticality as being a way of providing an instantaneous code for events that themselves occur with a wide range of probabilities. Okay. But the more important argument might be that in a network that's close to being critical, the dynamics will inevitably have, well, inevitably, that is to say, in all the examples we understand, have, right, there's no theorem. The dynamics is associated with this statistical notion of criticality is likely a very wide range of timescales in the dynamics. And one of the most fundamental problems in understanding the brain globally is the problem of bridging timescales. The dynamics of individual neurons, it's not exactly true, but largely is on the timescale of milliseconds. The timescale of our behavior is much longer. And the timescale of the events that we're trying to keep track of and think about are much longer. So how do we bridge those timescales? Networks that are near criticality do it automatically. Okay? Now, so maybe that's the reason, which would be sort of perverse, because actually that fact makes no appearance in the analysis that I'm doing. Right? So not only are do many things all come together at the critical point, that includes things that I'm not even keeping track of in the analysis, right? So it could easily be, even if everything I've told you is correct, the reason that stands behind it could be something I'm not telling you about. In the case of birds, for example, you might think that the diverging correlation length is a way of ensuring that you can communicate information over very long distances, so that if this bird sees something that makes him want to turn, that information gets communicated all the way across the flock, but without being in a state that's rigid. Right? So it's some compromise between long-range communication and maintaining flexibility or something like this. But it would be nice to actually have a formal version of that argument that really worked. It's sitting on the board. So suppose you stop here. You only keep track of pairwise correlations in the network of neurons. By the way, to answer the question, why do you pick this? Well, we pick this as the average probability that a neuron spikes, so the firing rates of the neurons. It seems plausible that networks that have very different firing rates are going to be different from each other. So let's be sure we get this right. Why do we pick this one? You want the real answer? Why is everybody worried about pairwise correlations? The answer is that when we started as a field, we could record from one neuron at a time. The next thing that happened was we could record from two neurons at a time. And so everybody spent a lot of effort to analyze pairwise correlations. And so that's fixed in the field's mind as the next thing to keep track of. Because historically, it was the next thing. It's by no means obvious that that's the right thing to do. Indeed, if you just keep these, then if you look at groups of neurons up to perhaps 20, you're doing essentially perfectly. So for example, what do I mean by perfectly? Well, you could predict this quantity and ask, do you get it right? And you do with very high accuracy. By the time you get to 40 neurons, if you look at this quantity, it still looks pretty good. But if you look carefully, you'll notice that your prediction of the probability that the network is completely silent is wrong by 1%. So you think, well, you know, this is biology. 1% accuracy is fantastic. No, it's not. The network is silent a significant fraction of the time. Spikes are rare. You've been recording for an hour. You have a very accurate measurement of the probability that the network remains silent. A 1% error is gigantic. Okay? That's the first sign that something is wrong. So you need something more than just this. And so what we decided to do was just take this itself. Again, because there are only n of these things. What you find, for instance, is that if you try to compute the triplet correlations, then if you stop here, again, if you look at a large network, you get the kind of qualitative trends right, but quantitatively you're missing quite a bit. When you add this, which by the way is not neuron specific, right? It's only asking about the global activity. Now you snap into a much better agreement. Your prediction of all the triplet correlations has an accuracy within a factor of two of the measurement error. Okay. So it seems that sort of keeping track of the global behavior of the network is very important. And you might argue that this is a hint that thinking about things pairwise is actually completely wrong. And it might be more natural, for instance, to imagine a neuron that's looking at this network. And what does it see? Well, this neuron adds up the information from this subgroup of neurons. And another neuron adds up the information from this subgroup of neurons. So you get quantities like this over subsets of cells, right? And maybe a handful of those is a much more natural way of describing the statistics than this thing. And that this really is just an artifact of the history of the field. And actually also an artifact of the desire to make too literal a connection between the maximum entropy approach and the microscopic models that were all the way at the other end of the board. Because of course, in this case, the maximum entropy model that you write down again has this sort of form, and it's tempting to think that these JIJs again live on the arrows. Okay, and so that temptation may be part of what focused people's attention here. So these experiments are recording from the ganglion cells, which are the output layer of the retina. And the cells in the output layer of the retina gather information across some radius. Okay. They don't contact every other neuron in that region, but they reach out to some radius. The radius that Michael and his colleagues record from is that radius. And in that neighborhood, there are about 200 neurons.
In this matrix JIJ, how many elements would be non-zero?
None of them.
Given a neuron?
The first approximation, none of them. That is to say, there is a distribution of J's, which is also peaked near zero, but there's no evidence that there is a subset of neurons that have the non-zero interactions, and then the rest of them are zero. It's not sparse. That's one of many attempts at simplification that fails.
Okay, so absolutely the last question from back there, since you've not asked any before.
Relevant variables and then computing the maximum entropy would work?
So if you want an example, essentially something like that's been done for the Vijay model in three dimensions. And actually there, I should say, so let me amplify the answer to that a little bit. The reason that you would think that this should fail is because we know from the analysis of models like the Vijay model and the work of Toner and Tu and Ramaswamy on the continuum version of this, that essentially because these are driven dynamical systems, one way to think about it is I only look to my neighbors, but then I'm moving, and so I can carry a memory of what my neighbor was doing, over to here, and now I talk to this guy, and that looks like this guy and that guy are interacting with each other, but of course they're not. And so effects like that would mean that the stationary probability distribution of the system is not decomposable into local terms like this. So that's the first observation. That's one of the reasons why you don't think this should work. So it's important, for instance, that you can try out this maximum entropy construction not by fixing the average correlation with all of your neighbors up to some radius, but you could try fixing your correlation with your nearest neighbor, your second nearest neighbor, your third nearest neighbor, and so on. And Andrea and Irena and their colleagues went and did this and showed that as you try to add more and more terms, the contribution of those terms dies off very quickly. So it really is true that a local description is sufficient to capture the whole behavior. And then they've gone on to actually try and construct dynamical versions of this in which you're matching the correlations not between velocities at the same moment in time, but at successive frames in the movie. And they've done that for the real data, and they've done that for Wycheck-like models, and asked under what conditions, you know, do you get the same answer, and under what conditions do you get different answers. So the model in which you match correlations at successive frames, that's microscopically sensible, because that corresponds to the statement that your dynamical interactions are local. The one in which you only try to match things in a single snapshot, that might work or it might not work. Depends. And so what they showed is that if you build the model that matches the dynamical correlations in the real data, then that is, and then you decode from that what the dynamical model, what the traditional dynamical model should be, and then you simulate that, it is in the regime where they should get the same answer. And so in some sense, flocks aren't especially active, essentially because they don't rearrange their neighbors very much. So the effect that I was describing is not that big. Okay. It could have failed. And there's certainly an example where it will fail, which is if you do it in two dimensions. Then it has to fail for reasons that the experts in the room will know and we could talk about.
Thanks.
Thank you.